The parasha of Bo that we read this coming Shabbos continues with the Makos that began earlier on. In the beginning of this week's parasha, the Torah describes the Mako of Arbe. Vayomer Hashem Moshe Bo al Paro, ki ani chvadati eslibo v'eslev avodov, leman shisi ososai ele bekirbo. And the Torah goes on then to describe Moshe and Aaron came before Paro, and they said to him in Pasuk Gimel, Korma Hashem Elokei HaIvrim, Ad Masai Me'anto Le'onos Miponoi, Shalach Ami V'yavduni. Ki Mo'in Ato L'Shalech Es Ami, Hiduni Mevi Machor, Arbe Bigvulecha. The Torah then, therefore, describes the Makkah of Arbe. This Makkah, as we know, was preceded by several other Makkos. Dom, Tzfardeya, Kinim, Orov, Dever, Shchin, Borod, and now we have Arbe, followed by Choshech and Makos Bechoros. We know that the Makos are divided into three sets, and they're actually, in a very pithy way, encapsulated by Rabbi Yehuda in the Agoda, Ditzach, Adash, V'Achav. There are many reasons why there are three sets of Makos. The Ramban, in his Perash al Torah, points out something very striking and very significant. We notice that the first two makos of each set, namely Dam and Tzfardeya, are accompanied by a hasra, by a warning. Kinim has no hasra. Orov and Dever, the second set, the first two makos of the second set, are accompanied by hasra. Shchin, the third mak of the second set, has no hasra. And similarly, Borod and Arbe are accompanied by Asura, and the third Makkah, Choshech, has no Asura. The Ramban theorizes that the first two Makkahs of each set had the potential ability to kill or to destroy, and therefore a warning was critical to forewarn Paro of the impending imminent disaster. The third Makkah of each set, Kinim, Shrin, and Choshech undoubtedly were uncomfortable, unpleasant, unsightly, but because they didn't carry such a fatal threat in their wake, a warning was unnecessary. Perhaps one could suggest, in line with the Ramban's explanation, the following. The first two makots, again, Dam requires some explanation, but even Dam, the Ramban assumes, is somehow inherent in the nature of water. And therefore, again, we are talking about the first two makos of each set are different than the third makos of each set. Dam and Tzfardeya, somehow a natural phenomena. Orov and Dever, the first two makos of the second set are also in tandem with nature. When the gates of the zoo are flung wide open, wild animals will have necessity, they'll rampage, they'll wander about aimlessly, they'll bring havoc and disease in their wake. Borod and Arbe, the first two makos of the third set, hailstorm and locust, are phenomena that have been confronted by farmers from time immemorial. Therefore, because these two makos, namely the first two of each set, could be easily misconstrued and misinterpreted by Paro and his cohorts to be the handiwork of nature, it would not be difficult for them to fail to see the Yad Hashem in these makos. Therefore, Moshe Rabbeinu had an issue, Asra, a warning. He had to say to Paro, forewarned is forearmed. Even though you may, in all likelihood, ascribe these makos to natural phenomena, I want you to know that the Yad Hashem is written here. Shalach Ami V'Yavduni. And that's why, prior to these makos, the first two of each said, Moshe Rabbeinu comes before Paro and warns him. Moshe Enkein, in the third makos of each said, here we see these makos are absolutely supernatural events. Kinim and Shrin and Choshech, Kofun Mechupo, there's no need for Asura. In other words, the Asura is based on what the Gemara says, Kolaroitze Litois Yavo V'Yite. Whoever wants to err, we have Bechir Choshis. Whoever wants not to see the Yad Hashem can easily do so. But in the context of the Makos in Mitzrayim, where the object of the Makos was to, in effect, underscore the Yad Hashem, the Echolos of Hashem, the Metzias of Hashem, as the Ramban and other Rishonim explain, this could not possibly happen. And therefore the Torah has divided the Makos beautifully, where the first two Makos of each set that are intended with nature, and Paro might err, here Moshe Rabbeinu was told, to issue Asra. Mashiach in the third Makos, that was so glaringly and blatantly and obviously supernatural, miraculous, in terms of the nature of the Makos, there was no need for any Asra. Asra is only necessary in the context of the Makos when there might be some sort of a toas, there might be some sort of an error. In order that Paro should not err, should not be led astray, Moshe Rabbeinu was told to deliver Asra prior to the Mako. Mashen came in the third Mako. Here there's no need for Asra. It's so clear and so obvious. And therefore, Moshe Rabbeinu did not come to Paro. There was no reason to say, Shalach Ami V'Avduni. So here we see one of the many beautiful explanations why the Makos are divided in a tripartite fashion, in a threefold type of way, pattern, and how the first two Makos of each set have Asra, the third Mako not, again, clearly addressing an issue which we constantly confront on an ongoing basis. We have Bechira Chafshis, often tend to see events in very natural kind of terms, in cause and effect kind of terms. HaKadosh Baruch Hu, the Ribbono Shel Olam, did not want that Paro should make this error, which often human beings do, and therefore the first two Makos that are in sync with nature require Asra. Telling Paro, look carefully. What you're going to see is the Yad Hashem and not the work of nature. The third Maka, it was unnecessary, and therefore that was not accompanied by Asra. This explains in a beautiful way the structure and the pattern that we see in the Makos fitting in very well into the structure that Rabbi Yehuda already articulated for us in the siman that we have in the Agoda, Tetzach, Adash, V'Achav.